live from New York City. It's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us today. We're going to be looking at genes and longevity and health and functional medicine with a physician in that particular area. We're going to continue with our Conversations with Remarkable Minds series, part two, where Camille Paglia and Dr. Jordan Peterson, Professor Peterson, are talking about the type of society we have today, the opinion leaders and policymakers, and where they have gone wrong, including community, without the actual constructs that we're all living under. What's wrong with society today? Very powerful, very deep series. These are deep thinkers, not superficial, as you will hear. Also, today we're beginning a series. Today, one of our scholars in residence, Richard Gale, and I will be discussing a new type of access to Wikipedia, how it's been hijacked, and by whom, and to what extent, Google and Facebook, and how even though these search optimization engines are very important if you want to collect some information, who's behind them? Why are they censoring people? Who are they censoring? How is that impacting all of us not being able to get that is more honest than the official story we promote? This is going to be a 52-part series. Part one begins today. But we always begin with the latest on health and healing. From the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine, they're talking about how the new study highlights the benefits of weekly nutrition to improve type 2 diabetes. And prescriptions simply are not enough. Diet changes and nutrition education make the difference in people with diabetes and prediabetes. And this, according to a study published in the Journal of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics, researchers from the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine set up a study in a private endocrinology clinic in Washington. After working hours, put the waiting room chairs in a circle and conducted free nutrition classes for diabetic patients. And although the patient's diabetes was generally well controlled at the outset, the classes significantly improved their weight, their blood sugar, and their cholesterol levels. And two different diets both proved effective during a 20-week study, a low-fat vegan diet and a portion-controlled eating program. Both groups ate the less fat and less cholesterol and less meat, and as a result, there was major improvements. From Dr. Neil Barnard, a physician who is a vegan, in fact, I just filmed him for a new documentary I'm doing, he said, doctors can turn their waiting rooms into classrooms. It's simple and very effective. Patients learn about healthy food changes and can share tips and swap recipe ideas and work through challenges together. Being in a class with other people who have the same goals has kept me on track. So now from my own experience, for 45 years, one of my closest friends, Dr. Martin Feldman, we were both personal friends, but also professional colleagues. There was never a health support group, and we did over 41 of them, some lasting a year, some a year and a half. And as a board-certified neurologist and an academic and an associate professor of neurology at Mount Sinai and an author of over 70 published articles in peer-reviewed journals, he brought a orthodox mindset to these studies that had nothing to do with orthodoxy. Every study that was done was based upon diet and lifestyle modification. But he was there to see blood chemistries and the medical records before and then at the conclusion of a study, and therefore how effective was that study. They were so that in every single instance, we were able to get the results out. Frequently were invited by very prestigious scientific groups, like going to Chicago once. We flew to Chicago for 4,000 doctors and scientists to present results of a study we did. And that one was also on diabetes. And Marty had a very small office. It was tiny, smallest in New York. And he had a little tiny room, a tiny, tiny waiting room, six people, and it filled it up, and a couple nurses' stations, and that's it. So he didn't have the room in his office, but I had a large space in my office, and I gave him a room. And twice a week, he would meet with his patients and do exactly what this study just did. Now, this is going back 40 years ago, and he would teach them about exercise, stress management, and proper diet and supplements. And I don't know of a single person that he was not able to either improve or completely eliminate their diabetes. So I'm glad that they did this. I hope more doctors do this. And you don't have to have a large group. You know, most could do 10 people and just spend an hour with them once a week. And that's doable. Because otherwise, you go into a doctor's office, you're given a quick prescription, almost nothing about diet or exercise, it's about a drug, and that's it. That's not where we should be going with this. We should be going by eliminating diabetes completely, and we can. Kimchi, K-I-M, Kimchi, which is like C-H-I. Now, I don't particularly like it. There's certain things I don't like. I don't like some of the herbs. They're too pungent, too bitter. I don't like some of the fermented foods. It's kind of yucky, especially if it's all the bacteria. But some people love it. In fact, South Korea, almost everyone there eats kimchi every day. And good that they do, because it's a power-packed with good bacteria. And now there's a study that Green Med Info published about the Koreans enjoying this salty and fermented vegetables group. And they've been doing it for 2,000 years. It's typically served with steamed rice at every Korean meal. And it's much more than just a condiment. Our researchers have published a comprehensive review of 130 peer-reviewed studies about how much probiotics, good bacteria, it has. And probiotics are good for your gut, and the gut has over 400 strains of bacteria, billions upon hundreds of billions of bacteria, and the mix of different strains in each person is very individual. But here's what happens when you have good probiotics. Now, you could get them from sauerkraut or any of the fermented foods that we commonly have in our like fermented pickles and fermented radishes and beets. It promotes a stronger immune system. It supports healthier digestion. It improves the amount of nutrients absorbed from food. It helps synthesize certain vitamins. It protects against tooth decay. It prevents diarrhea. It reduces the risk of colon cancer and bladder cancer. And probiotics in kimchi help the body detoxify from heavy metals and toxins, including biphenyl A, and also the organophosphorus pesticides. And the balance of good and bad bacteria in the gut can be disrupted by the use of antibiotics, because antibiotics, though necessary at times, are way overused in our society. They're also used in growing chickens and beef and pork, because antibiotics allows the animal to gain weight faster. Now, there's supposed to be a certain day when they stop using antibiotics in the feed so that the body is cleared of antibiotics, but we find out that's not the case. So you're getting antibiotics in much of the food that you eat, and that means in time you can build up an antibiotic resistance. So when you get a bacteria, you're going to be hurt. In addition to all of kimchi's traditional ingredients, we should also look at the ones that they can use in there that are good to themselves, like garlic, ginger, and red pepper. All very good, because you get carotenes and your B complex. So take your kimchi or some other probiotic, and it also increases collagen production, and it increases free radical scavenging, which means that you're going to have healthier skin, you're going to have more chlorophyll and more phenolics, all of which means you're going to be able to live a longer life. And by the way, there are other ingredients in kimchi, like and mustard and pears now, and pine nuts and chestnuts and ginkgo nuts and cereals. And I think it's the ginkgo nut, because when you ferment a ginkgo nut, it smells like vomit. And every time I run around Central Park in the fall, there's this kind of smell of someone puked. And that's you'll see the Oriental, generally the older women out there picking up these little nuts. One of the oldest trees in the world, the ginkgo biloba tree. And that's where they get that. They even use fish or crabs in some, so you have to read the ingredients if you're vegan, and cucumber and green onions in some. But you could just have good quality cabbage that is fermented. And then add your own garlic, ginger, and red powder, and you've got your own really powerful fermented food. I mentioned a couple of weeks ago that there's new research showing that sitting too much shortens your life. Now there's a new study from the University of Sao Paulo School of Medicine in Brazil, and they're saying, don't sit. If you sit too long, you're going to shorten your life. And they looked at 50 injuries linked with sitting for more than 3 hours a day. That's in the entire day, to a 3.8% of deaths from all causes. Wow. 3 hours a day you should sit? What about airline pilots? What about people working behind computers all day? They're sitting sometimes 8-10 hours a day. And then when they get home, they're tired and they sit in front of a computer or television. Remember what I said, 3 hours a day, that's all you can. And or you're going to take time off your life. Okay? Now, there's berries. They're good. But some are just better than others. And I would have to put amlaberry at the top, and right beside that, elderberry. Elder, as in an elder person, the L-D-E-R, berry, B-E-R-R-Y. Elderberries have been around a long time. Not common in the United States, very common in Europe. But according to Griffith University, that's in Australia, elderberry extracts can protect you against air pollution when you're in an airplane. So simply taking an elderberry supplement, and you can get a powder, I use it every morning, in a big mix I make of all kinds of powders. You take a teaspoon of elderberry powder before you get on a plane, put it into a smoothie, and that can reduce the duration and symptoms of the common cold for air travelers. And air travel is a challenging and demanding experience, and studies have shown that long-distance flights can result in fatigue, immune system impairment, and increase stress, putting you at a potential risk of infections. In fact, a new study published in Nutrients indicates that 600 to 900 milligrams, that's under a gram, which is a very small amount, of a standardized extract of elderberry, before and after travel, can shorten the duration of illness if you are finding yourself sick. And that was in a double-blind study. So I suggest elderberry all the time. A lot of times in Europe, especially in England, they have elderberry jam. I don't recommend that, because most of that is going to be gelatin with sugar, and you don't want that. Just take elderberry powder. There's nothing else there. It's just the powder. They just dried it, and pulverize it. And you take a teaspoon of that. That'll do the job. And also, from the University of California at San Diego, a study showing that low vitamin D levels are associated with higher cancer risk. And the study reinforces links between vitamin D status and the rates of breast, lung, and bladder cancer. And clear back to the 1980s. The findings from this analysis could help shape hair guidelines, making sure that people have their vitamin D each day. So we have we have two decades of studies, and it shows that according to the World Health Organization, cancer causes 20% of deaths in the European region, and with more than 3 million new cases, 1.7 million deaths every year from cancer. It's very important that we understand how to prevent it and what to do on a daily basis. So I'm suggesting about 2,000 to 3,000 units of vitamin D3 a day. And finally, from the Research Center for Nutrition and Food Safety, red wine offers to your heart by altering gut microbiome. Now, a compound found in red wine reduces the risk of heart disease by changing the quality of the microorganisms, the bacteria in your gut. And this focused upon resveratrol, res, R-E-S, vera, V-E-R-A, trol, three syllable, well. And you can take resveratrol milligrams a day. That would be terrific, 100 in the morning, 100 in the evening. You're not going to get a lot from red wine, but even the amount you get still was statistically significant and in what can do for cardiovascular disease. And a lot of people are dying from cardiovascular disease, and if you can prevent yourself from being a victim by taking something that simple, you do it. That's the latest on health and heat. We're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. And in a few minutes, we're going to be starting our first go-around at major organizations that we all trust or have up till now. And we are going to show you why we should no longer trust Facebook, Google, and especially Wikipedia. But it's not one fell swoop expose. We've been working on this for over a year. We have a lot to share with you. We'll have whistleblowers on that you have not heard from. We'll be the first to expose this. That'll be in about 3 minutes. I just want to take a moment because, once again, we've been out of Supreme Health Formula. As of today, it's back in stock. And here is the issue. Everyone should be taking a multiple vitamin mineral. Now, this is separate if you eat powder like green stuff, red stuff, cardio stuff, stuff, immune stuff, fiber stuff, which is back. I brought it back. Those are all important, but for a different reason. Those are loaded with phytonutrients and antioxidants and chlorophylls. Those are superstars. But that doesn't take care of the basic vitamin mineral profile that we're in. From my personal research, which is long in the field, I find almost everybody I counsel is deficient in different nutrients. So I set about creating one single type of supplement that you would take each day, once a day, in the morning. And I wanted to get everyone to think of that they would need, whether you're 60 or 16, athletic, normal weight or overweight. I wanted something to be full spectrum. And I took a careful look at all the ones on the market, and there's some good supplements on the market. And, of course, I have over 500,000 studies in the peer-reviewed literature on the chemistry, the safety of vitamins and minerals. And so I studied carefully. And so here's what I've done. I put together first vegan capsules. Why is that important? Because they break down immediately. Not everyone has a good digestive system. And just ask yourself, have you ever passed a vitamin through your body? And it came out whole. Well, that meant that either the tablet was compressed too hard or you have poor digestion. In either case, you're not benefiting from it. But when you have a vegan capsule, it breaks down almost instantly when it goes into the stomach. And if you even hold it for more than about 20 seconds in the mouth, it starts breaking down in the mouth. But then what do you put in this vegan capsule that would make a difference in a person's body? Well, I looked at the nutrients we're most likely to be deficient in, and I looked at the nutrients that I believe our body benefits from, what I call functional nutrients that really have good science behind them. And I start with vitamin A, and that includes palmitate and beta-carotene, 10,000 units. Then vitamin C, buffered vitamin C, 500 milligrams. Then vitamin D, 1,000 units. Natural vitamin E, which is different than synthetic, 200 units. And vitamin B1, 2, and 6, 25 milligrams each. And B12, 500 micrograms. And calcium from citrate and magnesium. It's more expensive to buy calcium and magnesium from citrate, but it's a much preferred type of vitamin C for its absorption. And I balance it both with 500 milligrams of each. Then I put manganese, chromium, molybdenum, and pantothenic acid, and also folic acid, 800 micrograms of folic acid, especially important for women. And then biotin, 300 micrograms. And then paraminobenzoic acid and vitamin K, and also iron, but from a vegan source of iron, ferrous sulfate. And zinc oxide, 15 milligrams, and boron, 3 milligrams, and iodine, and copper from lysinate from 2 milligrams, and potassium. And then I give you all of the superstars, like coenzyme Q10, quercetin, pycnogenol. By the way, there's 20 milligrams of pycnogenol in here, and if you Google the science behind pycnogenol, P-Y-C-N-O-G-E-N-O-L, you'll see why it's in here. It's a phenomenal nutrient. And ginkgo biloba, and green tea extract, and glutathione, and phosphatidylserine, and lutein, and citrus bioflavonoids, and N-acetylcysteine, and choline bitartrate, and inositol, and bromelain, melatonin, and acetyl-L-carnitine. Now, that's everything that's in here. You take 6 vegan capsules each morning. And we then did something else. I had Neil in my office write down the individual ingredients and the amount we have a month supply. And what would it cost you if you bought each of these items separately? Now, a lot of people can't afford to go buy their coenzyme Q10 and their phosphatidylserine and their ginkgo. But if you did, you'd be paying over $485. That's correct. That's how much we found at the retail value of all these nutrients that I have in this. And you're only paying $74.99. The regular price is $132.99. It's a huge discount. And we have, I think, 500 bottles right now in inventory. So if you want what I consider, in my belief, the finest, most comprehensive, all-inclusive, beneficial vitamin mineral supplement, you'll call 877-627-5065. 877-627-5065. 877-5065 and ask for Supreme Health Formula. And that way, at least you know you don't have to take all the individual bottles. You just take this each morning, and I'm covering all the bases I could think of in the human body. It's my belief that there is no better vitamin or supplement anywhere. at phenomenal savings over what you would pay if you bought them individually. And I include in here what I want it to do in your body. So call 877-627-5065 for the Supreme Health Formula. Now let's go over where standing by is Richard Gale. I'm Richard.
Yeah. Oh, good afternoon, Gary. We're going to...
Richard, we're beginning today with a new... We're beginning today, Richard, with a discussion of what we believed were very valuable tools to help us in our daily lives. And indeed, in many ways, they are Google, Facebook, and Wikipedia. However, our research, our original in-depth investigative reporting for the last year, shows that where indeed they could help us and have helped us, they also have agendas, and especially Wikipedia. And we're going to spread this out over a year, having different guests. Once a week, we will do a program, or part of a program, to exposing what we found to be just a completely unethical goings-on behind the scenes. And what concerns me is that this is at the same identical time that we're finding this out, that over 200 websites, many of those websites, we have them on the air. We respect them. Truthdig and Consortium News and some of the world, they are being considered as fake news, and they're not. And then people who are out and out giving misinformation, disinformation, are being promoted by these political campaigns. For example, where Facebook was supporting Obama, and that's now coming out. So I want you to go through now the problems that you have found in our investigations with each one of these, and give some details that we will further explore in an original article that we'll be doing later this week and posting, and then upcoming guests will be highlighting these discrepancies, where in effect we have a new form of digital media McCarthyism that is occurring as we speak. The form is yours.
Yes, Gary. There's two points. One was, and this is, as some people may have heard this before, it used to be said concerning the internet that the wonderful thing about the internet is that anybody anywhere can say anything, and that the worst thing about the internet is that anybody anywhere can say anything. And this has become, if you look at it in that these two kind of poles of nonsense and reality, that pretty well defines what Wikipedia is. It's become a war zone of conflicting biases. It's a battlefield. And unfortunately, there are groups, there are organizations and associations that have dominated the debate, particularly in the region and area of alternative health, medicine, anything concerning the paranormal in any way, even very, very legitimate research being done at some universities, like the University of Cambridge that has a big parapsychology department. Anything that questions the risks of genetically modified foods. Of course, anything concerning vaccines. The debate has been dominated by certain interest groups. And I'm going to focus on Wikipedia here because one has to wonder, here's an open source medium of to create basically an online encyclopedia. It was a very valid, noteworthy, honorable mission that when it first started. And and of course, to be able to create an encyclopedia is a huge, huge endeavor. But then one has to ask that even back in 2013, Wikipedia was worth over $6 billion. Now, how does something that's open source, doesn't have any advertising, there's no ads there, really, be able to generate that kind of money? And an anonymous senior employed Wikipedia editor has is coming forth. He's not revealed completely yet, so I don't have his actual name, but he said that the entire Wikipedia debate and content over health and medicine has been dominated by the pharmaceutical interest. One of the things the Wikipedia has to do is, because it can't employ all these different editors writing all this material up there, is that it's volunteered editors and writers that contribute, and they look for groups to do this for them. And so, therefore, out of that, there have been groups more powerful than others, particularly these associations that are called the skeptical societies, the science-based medicine groups, the groups like connected with the atheistic, groups of Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris, and the Amazing Randi, as some people may recall, was the magician who runs a big skeptical society to discredit anything concerning the paranormal. These are the groups that have now dominated the content on Wikipedia. So that's where we're going with respect to Wikipedia. With respect to Facebook, in fact, I just got an email today from not one of our favorite fans, but Roger Stone sent me an email today in his criticism about Facebook, because here's a company worth over $400 billion. And again, how does a company like that generate so much money or that kind of value unless you do something with the information that you acquire? And to kind of understand how they can now have been gathering the data on the figure I have is 230 million Americans. That's the total number of U.S. Facebook users in their database. These were to create psychological profiles. Whenever you hit click a like or a dislike, all this information is gathered. And even if you go and delete your page, that information they still retain. You have no privacy over this information whatsoever. So what basically happened here was that Facebook has been selling information in order to keep its revenues, keep its shareholders, stockholders happy. They gave permission to a professor, Alexander Kogan from Cambridge University, to create an app that would allow them to retrieve everybody's posts, everybody's pictures, all your likes and dislikes, all your online activity and other personal account and personality details about you, and to gather these to create psychological profiles on people. This was so Kogan, who actually is connected with Luke Oil of Russia, because he's also an associate professor at the University of St. Petersburg in Russia. They've then sold this to Cambridge Analytica, which was, people remember, is the company that was founded by Steve Bannon and many of the GOP Republican funders. This information is now being revealed, according to, I'm looking at Roger's post that he just sent me. Ted Cruz had used this during his last presidential campaign, and suspected Ben Carson had also been using it when he ran. So this is how our information is being used to profile us. And I think that's the key word. When we think of Google, when we think of Facebook, when we think of Wikipedia, when we even look at the censorship of alternative news sites, both left and right, this is all profiling. Profiling is the big game now, because if you profile people psychologically, you can have you can get an upper hand on them. This goes back to Edward Bernays, the master, the father of propaganda, back in the early part of the 20th century. It's the same rule book that's being used here in order how to profile people and then target people with their, to with their weaknesses, target their weaknesses in order to sell them products, in order to woo them into believing, you know, that there's a war on terror or any other kinds of things, or that alternative health and alternative medicine and supplements and changing your diet and lifestyle is just foolish nonsense, that better just go to your doctor and get prescribed a drug. This is where this whole thing is kind of going right now. And you got follow-up questions?
Okay, that's just a brief overview. No, that's we're just showing where we're going and why, because what is happening is they're selecting anyone who is a social, anyone who has made critical comments about any administration, Democrat or Republican, any agency of government like the FBI, CIA, Department of Energy, Department of Education, anybody who's gone against any corporate interests like Monsanto and GMOs and the sugar industry. So in effect, if you open your mouth about anything that could be perceived as a criticism, you're now on a target list. Now, we can tell you this absolutely because we will be revealing who's on these target lists and how their reputations are being destroyed. And what we should know about this, and we're going to actually prove that with Wikipedia, even when you find things that are wrong, in error, you can't change them. It's a closed-loop system. As Richard said, there's a small group of individuals who can control everything about a person once they're on Wikipedia. And we have spoken with many, many people who are on there, and they can't get off. They can't get the information corrected. Why? If you didn't put anything about yourself up there, why should someone, your enemy, be able to do that?
I just want to add one thing to listeners. Just to add one thing to listeners, though, to understand, these groups are very sophisticated. They are extremely sophisticated. And unfortunately, they actually have campaigns where they reach out to editors in other countries, so they cannot be held liable because they could be in Sri Lanka, they could be somewhere in Europe, they could be in Indonesia or Thailand. There is a group, and we will be bringing more forth about them, called the Guerrilla Skeptics of Wikipedia. It's one of these groups that is very aligned with pharmaceutical interests and the science-based medicine group. They have a campaign. They travel, they recruit, they train computer geeks, unemployed people, just in other countries, you know, young people, to do all this troll work and editing work. And it's a large network, though, of these, but the number of people that are kind of controlling and managing this is much smaller in their associations. So, but we'll be mentioning a lot of the names and who these people are coming up in the future. And just for listeners to listen to on Thursday's program, one of the Wikipedia editors who was actually hired by Deepak Chopra to try to handle his site will be coming on as a guest, and he'll give a lot more detail into the history and the wiki wars.
The whistleblowers. This is a major scandal. Richard, we're going to our clip now. Thank you very much. We look forward to having you back on later in the series.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Now, we're going, instead of going to a music break, we're going to go directly into part two of our guest is not ready right now. They're filming, it turns out. So we're going to go directly into part two of what we started yesterday, and I find this, it's a very deep conversation, but a very important one, the type we do not hear in the radio or television. And you've got Professor Peterson and Professor Paglia discussing what's going on in our society that we're not paying attention to, how it impacts us, and how we can change it.
Who had no business making large theoretical statements about anything.
Well, maybe part of it is that If you generate an intelligible doctrine of radical relativism, then there is no reason to assume that there are distinctions between categories of knowledge or between different levels of quality of knowledge, right? So I've seen the same thing in the psychology departments, although we have the, what would you call it, the luxury of being bounded at least to some degree by the empirical method and by biology, right? It's one of the things that keeps most of the branches of psychology relatively sane, you know, because the real world is actually built into it to some degree. But if you accept the postmodernist claim of radical relativism, then you completely demolish the idea that there are quality levels that are associated with education because everything becomes the same. Mm-hmm. And that seems to me to be a perfectly reasonable justification for maintaining ignorance. You know, like Foucault, I actually found him the most readable of the Lacan, Derrida, Foucault triad. You can read Foucault. I read Madness and Civilization and a couple of his other books, and I thought that they were painfully obvious. You know, the idea that mental disorder is in part a social construct is self-evident to anybody who has even a smattering of psychiatric training. I mean, the real narrow medical types tend to think of a mental disorder, let's say, as something that might be purely biological. They have a pure disease model, but nobody who's a sophisticated thinker ever thinks that. It's a partly because medicine is a brand of engineering, not a brand of science, because it's associated with health, and the diagnostic categories are hybrids between physiological observation and sociocultural condition. Everyone knows that. And so when I read Madness and Civilization, I thought, well, that's not radical, that's just bloody self-evident. But
well, you know, Foucault's admirers actually think that he began, you know, the entire turn toward a sociological, grounding of modern psychology. The social psychology was well launched in the 1920s, for example.
Right.
I mean, the levels of ignorance, these people who think Foucault is so original have not read Durkheim, they've not read Max Weber, they've not read Irving Goffman. Okay, so in other words, to me, everything in Foucault seemed obvious, okay, because I had read the sources from which he was borrowing without attribution. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, again, I know these people. I mean, I've met, in some cases, you know, knew them in graduate school, people who went on to become these admirers of Foucault, Lacan, Derrida. And I know what their training was. Their training was purely within the English department. That's all they ever knew. They never made any research outside of that, right? And so the idea, Foucault is simply this ease, a mechanism. It's like a little tiny kit by which they can approach everything in culture. But the contortions of language, the deliberate, labyrinthine, elitist language, at the same time as pretending to be a leftist, okay, this is one of the biggest frauds ever practiced.
So I got a story to tell you that you might like, because I've thought a lot about that use of language, you know, because language can be used as camouflage. And so here's the story. I think I got this from Robert Sapolsky. So he was talking about zebras, and zebras, of course, have stripes, and hypothetically that's associated with camouflage. But it's not a straightforward association, because zebras are black and white and they're on the veldt along with the lions. The lions are camouflaged because they're grass-colored, but the bloody zebras are black and white. You can see them like 15 miles away. So biologists go out to study zebras, and they're like making notes on a zebra, and they watch it, and then they look down at their notes, and then they look up, and they think, uh-oh, I don't know which zebra I was looking at. So the camouflage is actually against the herd, because a zebra is a herd animal, not an individual. And so the black and white stripes break up the animal against the herd, so you can't identify it. So this was a quandary for the biologists, so they did one of two things. One was drive a Jeep up to the zebra herd and use a dab of red paint and dab the haunch of the zebra, or tag it with an ear tag like you use for cattle. The lions would kill it. So as soon as it became identifiable, the predators could organize their hunt around that identifiable animal. That's why, you know, there's the old idea that lions and predators take down the weak animals, but they don't. They take down the identifiable animals. So that's the thing, is if you stick your damn head up, you get picked off by the predators. And so one of the things that academics seem to do is congregate together in herd-like entities, and then they share a language, right?
Yes.
And the language unites them, and also keeps them, as long as they share the same set of linguistic tools among themselves, they know that there isn't anybody in the coterie that's going to attack them or destabilize the entire herd. And that seems to me to account for that impenetrable use of language. It's group protection strategy, and it has absolutely nothing to do with the search for... It's the search for security within a system and not the desire to expand the system.
So true. But to me, it's blatantly careerist, because it was about advancement, and it was also about the claim that somehow they have like special expertise. This is a special technical language no one else can understand, and only we can. But what's absurd about it, absolutely ludicrous, right, that these people, these American academics, are imitating the contorted language of French translations from the French. Okay, when Lacan is translated into English, right, there's a contortion there. Okay, what he was trying to do in French was to break up, okay, the neoclassical formulations that descended from Racine. There was something that was going on. There was a sabotage of the French language going on that was necessary in France, not necessary in English. We have this long tradition of poetry going back to Shakespeare and Chaucer. We have our own language, far more vital than the French.
Oh yeah, the French constrain their language all the time.
Yes, sir.
By bureaucracy.
The absurdity in the amateurism, okay, of American academics, okay, trying to imitate, okay, a translation of Lacan, okay, when Lacan's doing something in France that is absolutely not necessary and indeed wrong to be doing in English. All right? So the utter cynical abandonment, okay, of the great tradition of the English departments. Right? And I felt that the true radicalism was not about adding on other departments. Okay, so we have African American studies and women's studies and so on. The true radicalism would have been to shatter the departmental structure. That's what I wanted. I feel that was the authentic revolutionary 1960s thing to do, right? To blend all the literature studies, you know, studies together, okay? To make an interdisciplinary kind of organization, closer to the British model, where a person can pursue related subjects, overlapping subjects. These departmental models, okay, were to me totalitarian to begin with, okay? Separating language into fiefdoms, okay? and what this did to create women's studies department absolutely out of the air. Just snap your fingers and create women's studies. The English department had taken a century to develop. Okay, it was a huge argument. Okay, within it, right? And all of a sudden to create, okay, a department with a politicized agenda from the start. Okay, by people without any training, whatever in that field. Okay, what should be the parameters of the field? What should be the requirements of that field? How about biology? Okay, if you're going to be discussing gender, that should have been a number one requirement. Okay, as part of any women's studies department or program.
Yes.
But no, okay, it was all hands off. It was just the administrators wanted to solve a public relations problem. Okay? They had a situation with very few women faculty nationwide at a time when the women's movement had just started up. The spotlight of attention was on them. They needed women faculty fast. They needed the women's subject on the agenda fast. Right. So they just like, poof, let there be women's studies. Okay, and now we'll just hire some women, usually from English departments, here and there, and we'll just throw them together. You invent it. You say what it is. So that's why women's studies got frozen at a certain point of ideology, okay, of the early 1970s. I was already in revolt from it. Okay, I was a precursor in terms of my endorsement of feminism before even now was created. Right, but I couldn't even have a conversation with any of these women. They were hysterical about the subject of biology. They knew nothing about hormones. Okay, I mean, I probably got in fist fights over this. People were so convinced that biology had nothing whatever to do with gender differences. Right?
See, that also seems to me to be related to the postmodern emphasis on power.
Yes.
Because there's something terrible underground going on there, and that is, and I think this is the sort of thing that was reflected in the Soviet Union too, especially in the 20s, when there was this idea, a radical idea, that you could remake human beings entirely, right? Because they had no essential nature.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so if your fundamental hypothesis is that nothing exists except power, and you believe that, then that also gives you the right, in some sense, to exercise your power at the creation of the kind of humanity that your utopian vision envisions. And then that has no... And that also seems to me to justify the postmodern insistence that everything is only a linguistic construct. It again goes down to the notion of power, which Derrida and Foucault and Lacan are so bloody obsessed with. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me what they're trying to do is to take all the potential power for the creation of human beings to themselves without any bounding conditions whatsoever, right? There's no history, there's no biology, and everything is a fluid culture that can be manipulated at will. And so, I mean, in Canada, there are terrible arguments right now about biological essentialism, let's say, and one of the things that happened, which was something I objected to precisely a year ago, is that the social constructionist view of human identity has been built now into Canadian law. So there's an insistence that biological sex gender identity, gender expression, and sexual proclivity very independently with no causal relationship between any of the levels. Mm-hmm. And so that's in the law, and not only is it in the law, it's being taught everywhere. It's being taught in the armed forces, it's being taught in the police, it's being taught to the elementary school kids and the junior high school kids. And underneath it all, I see this terrible striving for arbitrary power that's associated with this crazy utopianism. And but I still don't exactly understand it. I don't understand that what seems to be the hatred that motivates it, that you see bubbling up, for example, in identity politics and in the desire to do nothing but, let's say, demolish the patriarchy. It kind of reminds me, and this is something else I wanted to talk to you about, you know, and you're an admirer of Erich Neumann and of Carl Jung. Yeah, and that's the Neumann connection is really interesting because I think he's a bloody genius. Yeah. I really like The Great Mother is a great book and really a great warning, that book, and also The Origins and History of Consciousness.
One of my most influential books, yeah.
Yeah, that's so interesting. Yeah. I read an essay that you wrote. I don't remember when it was.
A lecture I gave on Neumann at the NYU, yes.
Yes, it's always been staggering to me that that book hasn't had the impact that it should have had. I mean, Jung himself, in the preface to that book, wrote that that was the book that he wished that he would have written. It's very much associated with Jung's Symbols of Transformation, and it was a major influence on my book, Maps of Meaning, which was an attempt to outline the universal archetypes that are portrayed in the kind of religious structures that you put forward. But the thing that I really see happening, and you can tell me what you think about this, in Neumann's book, consciousness, which is masculine, symbolically masculine for a variety of reasons, is viewed as rising up against the countervailing force of tragedy from an underlying feminine, symbolically feminine unconsciousness, right? And it's something that can always be pulled back into that unconsciousness. That would be the microcosm of that would be the Freudian Oedipal mother familial dynamic, where the mother is so over protective and all-encompassing that she interferes with the development of the competence, not only of her sons, but also of her daughters, of her children in general. And it seems to me that that's the dynamic that's being played out in our society right now, is that there's this, and it's related in some way that I don't understand to this insistence that all forms of masculine authority are nothing but tyrannical power. So the symbolic representation is tyrannical father with no appreciation for the benevolent father, and benevolent mother with no appreciation whatsoever for the tyrannical mother, right? And that's that. And because I thought of ideologies as fragmentary mythologies. That's where they get their archetypal and psychological power, right? And so in a balanced representation, you have the terrible mother and the great mother, as Neumann laid out so nicely, and you have the terrible father and the great father. So that's the fact that culture mangles you half to death while it's also promoting you and developing you. You have to see that as balanced. And then you have the heroic and adversarial individual. But in the postmodern world, and this seems to be something that's increasingly seeping out into the culture at large, you have nothing but the tyrannical father, nothing but the destructive force of masculine consciousness, and nothing but the benevolent great mother. And it's an appalling ideology, and it seems to me that it's sucking the vitality, which is exactly what you'd expect symbolically. It's sucking the vitality out of our culture. You see that with the increasing demolition of young men, and not only young men, in terms of their academic performance, which, like, they're falling way behind in elementary school, way behind in junior high, and bailing out of the universities like mad. And so,
Well, the public school education has become completely permeated by this kind of anti-male propaganda. I mean, to me, public schools are just a form of imprisonment, you know, right now. Mm-hmm. They're particularly destructive to young men who have a lot of physical energy, okay? Now, you know, I identify as transgender, okay, myself, okay, but I do not require the entire world to alter itself, okay, to fit my particular self-image. I do believe in the power of hormones. I believe that men exist and women exist and are biologically different. I think there is no cure for the culture's ills right now, except if men start standing up, okay, and demanding that they be respected as men again.
Okay, so I got a question about that. So one of the things, we did a research project a year ago trying to figure out if there was such a thing as political correctness from a psychometric perspective, to find out if the loose aggregation of beliefs actually clumped together statistically. And we actually found two factors, which I won't go into. But then we looked at things that predicted adherence to that politically correct creed. And there were a couple that were surprising. One was being female was a predictor. the personality attributes associated with femininity, so that would be agreeableness and higher levels of negative emotion, were also both independent predictors, but so were symptoms of personality disorder, which I thought was really important, because part of what I see happening is that, like, I think that women whose relationship with men has been seriously pathologized cannot distinguish between male authority and competence and male tyrannical power. Like, they fail to differentiate because all they see is the oppressive male. And they may have had experiences their experiences with men might have been rough enough so that differentiation never occurred, because it has to occur. And you have to have a lot of experience with men, and good men too, before that will occur. But it seems to me that we're also increasingly dominated by a view of masculinity that's mostly characteristic of women who have terrible personality disorders and who are unable to have healthy relationships with men. Now, but here's the problem. You know, this is something my wife has pointed out too. She said, well, men are going to have to stand up for themselves. But here's the problem. I know how to stand up to a man who's unfairly trespassing against me. And the reason I know that is because the parameters for my resistance are quite well defined, which is we talk, we argue, we push, and then it becomes physical, right? Like if we move beyond the boundaries of civil discourse, we know what the next step is. Okay, that's forbidden in discourse with women. And so I don't think that men can control crazy women. I really don't believe it. I think that they have to throw their hands up in it's not even disbelief. It's that the cultural, there's no step forward that you can take under those circumstances, because if the man is offensive enough and crazy enough, the reaction becomes physical right away, or at least the threat is there. And when men are talking to each other in any serious manner, that underlying threat of physicality is always there, especially if it's a real conversation, and keeps the thing civilized to some degree. You know, if you're talking to a man who wouldn't fight with you under any circumstances whatsoever, then you're talking to someone to whom you have absolutely no respect. But I can't see any way. For example, there's a woman in Toronto who's been organizing this movement, let's say, against me and some other people who are going to do a free speech event, and she managed to organize quite effectively. And she's quite offensive, you might say. She compared us to Nazis, for example, which, you know, publicly, using the swastika, which wasn't really something I was all that fond of. But I'm defenseless against that kind of female insanity, because the techniques that I would use against a man who was employing those tactics are forbidden to me. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Like, it seems to me that it isn't men that have to stand up and say enough of this, even though that is what they should do. It seems to me that it's sane women who have to stand up against their crazy sisters and say, look, enough of that, enough man-hating, enough pathology, enough bringing disgrace on us as a gender. But the problem there, and then I'll stop my little tirade, is that most of the women I know who are sane are busy doing sane things, right? They're off, they have their career, they have their family, they're quite occupied, and they don't seem to have the time or maybe even the interest to go after their crazy harpy sisters. And so I don't see any regulating force for that terrible femininity. And it seems to me to be invading the culture and undermining the masculine power of the culture in a way that's, I think, fatal. I really do believe that.
I too believe that this is symptomatic of the decline of Western culture, and it will just go down flat. I don't think people realize that, you know, the masculinity still exists, okay, in the world as a code among jihadists, okay, and when you have passionate masculinity, okay, circling the borders like the Huns and the Vandals during the Roman Empire, that's what I see this culture rotting from within, okay, and disemboweling itself, literally. Now, I have an overview of why we're having these problems, right? And it comes from the fact that I'm the product of an immigrant family. All four of my grandparents and my mother were born in Italy. So I remember from my earliest years in this factory town in upstate New York, where my relatives came to work in the shoe factory, I can remember still, okay, the life of the agrarian era, okay, which was for most of human history, okay, the agrarian era, where there was the world of men and the world of women, and the sexes had very little to do with each other. Each had power and status in its own realm. Right? And they laughed at each other, in essence. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. The women had enormous power. In fact, the old women ruled, not the young, beautiful woman like today. Okay? But the older you were, the more you had control over everyone, including the mating and marriage. There were no doctors, so the old women were like midwives and knew all the ins and outs of this inherited knowledge about pregnancy and all these other things. Right? I can remember this and the joy that women had with each other. All day long, okay, cooking with each other, companions to each other, talking, conversing. My mother remembered as a small child in Italy when it was time to do the lawn.
That is the end of part two. We will continue with part three tomorrow. It's a five-part series. You've been listening to Camelia Paglia and Jordan Peterson, both professors, both extremely deep and critical thinkers. And there are just many gems of information. Now, you can agree or disagree, but they're attacked and have been attacked, Paglia, throughout her whole career, because she wouldn't toe the line of what the official feminism line was. And much of that line was antagonistic. Men were always the culprits and to be challenged. And when you think of how many people saw through that, and that's why there was never this great embrace of the feminist movement. Also, all spiritual feminists, the people you're bringing on this program, were excluded from the dialogue. So I want to thank you all for listening to that. Tonight, we have one of the spiritual feminists, one of the greatest thinkers on the planet, Professor Elizabeth Sartoris. She's an evolutionary biologist, a futurist, a former professor specializing in living systems design, and she's going to talk with me tonight for a full hour on understanding worldview dynamics, how beliefs create limited worldviews, and the clash of paradigms today and the need for a future living economy to sustain the preservation of our species ahead. It'll be a very deep conversation, and you won't want to miss it. So spread the word, 7 o'clock tonight. Great spiritual feminine, great, and a person that sees the world. We'll be talking to her from Hawaii, 7 o'clock tonight. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.